Good morning.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Good evening. I had to put speaker view.
Hello, Ajay.
Hey, sir.
Namaskar. Kaise ho?
Bahut badhiya, sir.
Good, good, good.
Better than yesterday.
Recruitment slow ho gaya hamara 2022 wala.
Pakad mein aa jayega sir. Abhi jara piche 3 din kaam pe the jara farm pe.
Acha, acha.
Wahan bahut jara barish ho gayi thi to isliye few challenges the.
Maharashtra to news mein hai bahut hi so many people died.
It's not stopping for last 5 days, sir.
Thank you.
नमस्कार सर, आज बहुत अच्छा दिन है।
नमस्कार सर,
नमस्कार,
गुड इवनिंग सर,
थैंक यू, नमस्कार, ग्रेट। अजय, हाउ आर यू? गुड इवनिंग, नमस्कार।
बहुत बढ़िया सर, फैन।
गुड इवनिंग इंद्रमणि, योर फेस इज गेटिंग कट, योर फेस, एडजस्ट द स्क्रीन,
ओके ओके,
कैमरा। Oh, that is nice. Now it's good. Now it's good, happy.
Thank you.
Gajendra ji, this is Jitendra Srivastava from Washington.
Oh, and namaskar.
Yes, I just enjoyed your effort you are making to promote these new technologies. And I really believe, and I'll be very happy sometime to talk with you more. But this, the new technologies have to come to India with less water, less land, and some more technology. So I congratulate the whole group for organizing this. I am a great believer for the future of urban agriculture and so forth. And I will listen to the deliberations very, very carefully. Thank you.
Did you listen to the last one we had on CA, conservation?
I was able to hear the presentation, not the live one, but in the one which was sent into YouTube or video. I am not the greatest on technology, computers, but I try to listen. And then I heard the parts that you talked about, conservation agriculture and the urban agriculture. Yes, I did. And I decided for sure to be here and listen to the whole thing because I believe India needs it. It should be supported. It will provide the young entrepreneurs to come, and therefore I'm very interested and very supportive. Thank you so much,
Dr. Srivastava. It'll be very helpful to the group if you just give a little introduction about yourself. Only thing I will say, that Dr. Srivastava was one of our teachers at Pantnagar, and he has been with International Agriculture System, including World Bank. So maybe Dr. Srivastava, can you give a little bit about, because this will encourage the group.
Let me be as humble as can be. You could say what you want, but I believe and that this technology, India should not fall behind. It is moving globally, and it is the private is a beautiful example of youth and private sector to come into it and benefit themselves and benefit the country and the world. This is a really will go on. Thank you so much.
We are extremely happy to see you on this group. Maybe we can see you somewhere on the picture, Sayed. I don't know.
Let me put it on the video for a second.
Because you are the senior most in this group. See, you were my teacher. So so look, and I have so many students here right in front. Indramani, Sayed Ismail, and so many of them. Okay. So.
I'm too interested to see him, sir.
Oh, Tiwari ji is there. Okay. Oh yeah. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Srivastava. Dr. Srivastava retired from World Bank and lives in Washington D.C. area.
Thank you.
I think Dr. Ramesh Deshpande will also join.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, Sayed.
Mm-hmm. We start.
Yeah, I will start.
Yeah.
Uh, today is a good day, and as I see, probably I read from the last three lines, the one who inspires, one who informs, one who recites, one who guides, one who teaches, and the one who awakens are the six groups to remember. I have several gurus in this group considering these points, and I am a guru. I'd like to the reason for me to start this particular session on conservation agriculture I'm going to say many experts are here, I'm aware of it, but I have probably the least experienced person in this line, but I think I have around 16, 17 years experience in the university as well as in research and as well as manufacturing and exporting precision agriculture equipment to Germany. And last 5 years, I've been very keen to understand. I was happy to be with many forums and even with farmers. So I know all these points what you talk. I want to brief. Everybody have their perspective. I want to know the reason how I see this through. The first, the whole world is looking, and India's challenge is food security. What do you say? That is, food security means the production. As for the records I see, I think we have more than 300 million tons of cereal production, and we produce a little bit of vegetables, more than cereals. And we also have animal products, which means the fisheries, milk and meat and eggs and everything. These are all from Dr. Gajan Singh's statistics, what I gave. So we produce enough, more than enough. Actually, we produce 30% of more sugar. And for the last 7 years, to my knowledge, most of the godowns have. And we also hear about the rice. We have no place to stock, and we can produce biofuel. So these are all the problems. We come to the second one, is the nutritional value. It's a bit less, we are lagging. So we have to improve the nutritional value of the people's intake. Quality is a problem. Today morning also in Times of India, 20% of the food samples collected in Uttar Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, as well as in Manipur, they are less quality, 20%. And we also know here about adulteration, everything. This important thing we have to consider. Another important thing which disturbs me is the import of oil seeds. We import only next to the petroleum products, oil seeds more than India, which India used to produce enough oils before. This is another issue we have. We have not much significant exports of agriculture produce because one of the reasons rice, for example, we cannot export because of the chemicals we use and different other reasons, and the cost is more, whatever may be. One critical point I want to say here, very important point, is wastages. We have around 15-20% of pre-harvest losses. I mean, this could be monsoon, this could be animal, many things, many reasons behind it, wastages. And we have almost 50 to 60% wastages from farm to fork, especially it's very high in vegetables and fruits. So if we stop this itself, we have enough, to my understanding, we have enough of food security we can create if we improve the nutritional value and the quality. Then we come to our challenge. Next challenge is soil health. Our soil structure has changed. For example, the hard pan is damaged in the paddy. This is what I heard from a lot of people. And the nutrition value, for example, 2015, I think the TNAU soil scientists told, and it's published in the, I saw a publication in Hindu, saying around, we lost about 50% of the soil nutrition in the last 30 years. And recently somebody was telling about 30% in 20 years. So because that is one of the biggest problems we are facing now, and with the problem with the micronutrients is the biggest issue. We have acute salinity problems, and of course the environmental issues related to the soil health. We have vegetation, less vegetation, whatever. These are all regarding soil health. So this is important challenge we have in Indian agriculture. Third one we have, the challenge is quality of inputs. Seeds is still a problem. I have been in the field for last 1.5 years, meeting farmers and seeing seed supply is a real issue. We don't care. We have to really care for it. Then second thing is the water. You see, 60 to 70% of water is used in agriculture. We use only 4% for the households, and around 4 somewhere similar amount in industrial, but and probably 12% around for the thermal plants. So, but we don't save the water. The problem is the water. We use too much water. Another problem is we are pumping more groundwater than USA and China put together. This is something we have to really ask ourselves. Do we really have to use? The water below the surface belongs to the soil, not for us. Then we come to the next point. Important point is we have the fertilizer. You see, out of the 2.5 lakh crores, the Indian subsidy, there are three subsidies are given, and that is one for the food, fertilizer, and petroleum products. And fertilizer has approximately 70,000 crores fertilizer. Now I give you a figure, some of the figures for you to see, compare it. The fertilizer cost, that is a per ton, around 5,000 rupees. Actually, government gives subsidy of 10,000 rupees. So that the subsidy was given before directly to the factories. Now it is given by DBT only after it is given to the farmers. So there's still the subsidies. So farmers see the chemicals are cheaper and they are using it. And the how much a farmer gets benefit out of it is about 2,000 rupees, 2,500 rupees per acre. This is the figure it comes to fertilizer subsidy. This, I think we have to do something really. This is, we all the people we have to see, we have, I'll come back to the next point afterwards. Chemicals we use heavily. We have to see how to reduce it. Farming techniques, I mean, erosion is very, very high, and salinity, we have absolutely no more of water conservation or soil conservation, local ponds, they are all non-existent now anymore. We use a very high energy inputs where it's not required. For example, solar energy excellent when we pump surface, I mean near surface water, river water pumping is okay. But groundwater to pump using solar energy and people running for 12 hours, 14 hours, 12 hours throughout the sunlight is there. That's a waste of, I mean, the resources, everything. And we have already, we know about cancer experts in Punjab. Quality of inputs this way. Then we come to the farmer's income. I give you some figures now. See, there are marginal farmers. We have normally about 2 acres, whatever the figure says. I will give you a figure of, let us say, marginal farmer earns around 1,500 to 2,500 rupees per month per acre. Whereas when you go to so-called the blessed farmers, I call the big farmers, the Punjab and Haryana farmers, they get 6,500 to 8,000 rupees per month per acre. Okay. Now, it is very important this. I think we need the figures, how much they earn. And this is the figures I have taken from different statistics data, which is given approximate data. Now, we see again the GDP contribution, we know about 15% only we get, somewhere 10 to 15%. Whereas we have 50% of people who are employed in agriculture. People always stick to this point, a few points, and then we discuss. But I think that is one part of it. But the major part of the problem is the serious problems also there. We come back to the next one, the stakeholders. The stakeholders on this whole thing, as I see, as the universities and scientists. The reason I tell you, university scientists, they're paid 2.5 lakhs, 2 lakhs, 1.5 lakhs per month. Imagine how much a farmer, how many acres he must have to make that amount of money. Even the government servant, he gets 50, 70,000 rupees minimum salary. So that is the reason problem of more people not willing to spend money in agriculture. So we have to see very carefully the reasons. I don't have solutions for all of them, but I think we have a team of people. We can see that how to increase the income of the farmer. I don't think you can do only by fertilizer subsidy. Unfortunately, I find we have experts. Most of the committees are chaired by vice chancellors and the scientific institute heads. That we cannot say no. That's what it is, truth. And of course, politicians and administrators are also there. But I think we have to take more responsibility, and probably we can help to change it. We have one acute problem here is a vice chancellor belonging to one particular domain, he supports that domain. For example, he's an agronomist. He'll only talk on agronomy. He is a plant pathologist. This exists. And plus the professors under him don't talk much also. The question is, every vice chancellor thinks 4 years my service, I'll leave and go, why I have to create trouble? So these attitudes are the main reason why I have brought up to this level, probably. This is from a layman's point of view, I see from outside. And I think probably I leave it to the forum at the end of this today's session. Some small discussions can be done. If this, I made it, this is the reason I thought probably we should save the nature and produce more for the farmer, for the people. So produce, conserve the land with the conservation agriculture, production also more there, and then come to urban agriculture where you can produce on demand when and where required. With these few words, I'd like to close this. And I will introduce today's topic. Today's topic is urban agriculture, the first one. We, as I told you, we plan to have several sessions on conservation agriculture and urban agriculture. Our objective is to create awareness, and all the scientists and professors, as well as farmers. Last time we involved two farmers. This time also we try to involve two farmers. I would request, folded hands with you, please help the group to get more speakers, farmers, and the scientists to come out. We need the scientists to come and interact. This particular group, what we are doing, is not associated with anyone. So we are independent. It's all voluntary. So I think we can speak our open heart to see how to do it. So I will start the session with the first speaker. I'd like to invite Dr. Murtaza Hassan. He has a PhD from ICR, IRA he has got, and he is also working in PUSA IRA. He has got a master's award certificate from IIM Lucknow, and he has got about 100 papers published. He has guided 20 MTech students, and he has also worked with projects funded with the DSG World Bank, ICR, CPI. And he has given 50 live recorded programs on national Doordarshan, all these channels. He has been to, as well as he's worked, as well as he got acknowledgments from Masau, that is from Israel, and Novadedes Agricolas from Spain for the work he has done in protective cultivation, drip irrigation in IRI. He has been recently involved as technical expert and member of DST, TIFAC GOI, National Water Mission, Ministry of Water Resources, and Bureau of Indian Standards, National Horticultural Board. He is also a member of ISAE and Indian Society of Water Management and Indian Society of Protective Cultivation. He has 21 years experience of teaching, and we already know him already in this group. So he has been dedicated for the protective cultivation. The floor is yours, Dr. Murtaza.
Thank you, Dr. Ismail sir. Respected Gajendra Singh sir, Dr. Tiwari sir, Indramani sir, Ajay Singh sahab, my colleagues speaker today, Dr. Sandeep Jain, and other colleagues from ICR, from SAUs, and also from Indian Society of Agriculture Engineers, and one very important attendees today, and he shall speak today also, one very professional farmer, Mr. Sunil Sharma from Alwar, Rajasthan. I welcome you all. It's really a privilege to talk on the topic that is related to protected cultivation, and then it is very much related to urban agriculture also, and then very concerted efforts have been going on to promote this technology from government sides, from entrepreneur sides, from different bodies also now. So now, first I will share my screen and then start the presentation. I hope the slide is now visible to all. The first slide.
Yes. Yes, okay. Go ahead, please.
Okay. So the topic is today is that is the protected cultivation technology, research and initiatives. This is the picture from the place where I am working at present. That is the Center for Protected Cultivation Technology. It is located at IERI. And our farm especially, that is 25-acre farms where we are doing all the concerted efforts towards the main focus that is on protected cultivation technology. Coming to the first slides, that is the topic, that is the protected cultivation of horticulture crops. In brief, what it is all about. So first that, what I could understand it, that this technology particularly, it's a very good, you can say, mixture or amalgamation of engineering, agriculture, and automation. And nowadays, there is a word that is the controlled environment agriculture. It's a very common words now being used by different funding agencies, specialists, and many foreign institutes also, where lots of courses going on related to this controlled environment agriculture. So protected cultivation is very much related to it. And then we have been listening about one of the type of farming, that is the precision farming that we say, where we apply all the inputs in the right time, right place, and right amount. So I think this technology certainly deals with it. Then one of the common thing is that why we at present need this technology, especially in a country like India. You see now that nowadays, lots of biotic and abiotic stresses are prevalent in almost now every part of the country, mainly due to the climate change, lots of changes due to the climatic factors that comes under the abiotic stress. And we can now see that what is happening now. We have extreme events like flood, drought, very high rain in very less time. So these are all comes under the abiotic stress. And then as a engineers, we deal with this abiotic stress. But biotic stress is also very important because now in IERI, when we are working with the team, with the all the scientists related to plant protection group and pathology, entomology, and nematology, what they are saying that there is also now so many biotic stress nowadays prevalent. So many diseases are coming, that very complex diseases are coming and affecting the crops. So these things are very important nowadays. So overall, if we do the protected cultivation technology properly, then we can certainly deal with biotic and abiotic stress. It's not that in protected cultivation, we can totally get rid of 100% all the stresses, but we can certainly control the factors. Then another very important point is that we have been working on lots of aspects like automation, IoT, and sensors, which clearly shows us through the research that when we use this type of modern tools, it helps in ultimately increasing the production, then decreasing the energy part, better management, and also saving of inputs. Then, especially in northern India, it is very difficult to have the round-the-year cultivation. That is, we have extreme summer, we have extreme winter also. So in these of in modes, especially how to do the round the year cultivation possible. So protected cultivation also helps in these facts. There are lots of examples of protected cultivation like greenhouse, net house. These are the words that we listen very, very commonly in presentations. Nursery, tunnels, shade net, shelters. I will show these structures in my subsequent slides. Then what we could found that when we use this type of technology, there is a lot of saving of water and nutrient through the use of water harvesting, drip fertigation, other modern irrigation tools and fertigation tools, which is possible through the protected cultivation. And now some very advanced module of protected cultivation in the form of vertical farming, in the say like soilless, hydroponics and aeroponics nowadays. These are the tools, and you can say the latest advanced or advanced modules of protected cultivation, in which now many universities, IITs, NIITs, and State Agriculture University, now they are working. This slide I included that because this technology is now adults also have been using for entrepreneurship development. So there are few technologies that we have tried so far at, and it had, they have been tried by different ICR institutes also, that naturally ventilated greenhouse, or almost you can say zero energy model greenhouse with low pressure drip fertigation. So this is one of the models particularly used by Indian farmers in remote conditions. Then plug tray nursery raising technology, in which in the greenhouse, we do not do the crop production, but we actually raise the nursery and sell the seedlings. This technology particularly, we have found it is very popular for entrepreneurship development. Then we have modified different protected structures and grow different horticulture crops as per the need of the farmer, as per the need of the particular area, as per the agroclimatic regions. And then it has also been found good technology for entrepreneurship development. And then now presently, these advanced protected cultivation modules, as I've discussed in the last slide, many entrepreneurs and the professionals, they are coming and for entrepreneurship development, having the background, mostly I found in engineering, in management, and also defense sectors. Many in defense, many persons are getting retired very early and they want to do some modern cultivation, especially now the peri-urban cultivation, you can say, in the form of vertical farming, whether it is soilless, hydroponics and aeroponics. Many entrepreneurs are coming to us and then we are trying to help us through our institute, through our center for protected cultivation technology. I could find some reference that worldwide, what is the major, the countries having the greenhouse production, although it's slightly old data, but 2016 data says that you can see that China almost 28 lakh hectares. Now it is almost around 50 lakh hectares. Korea, Spain, Japan, Turkey. At that time, 2016-17, in India, it was almost only about 30,000 hectare. But now I will show you the in the next slide, the present data also, the Italy. So these are the few countries where mostly you can say that China is leading. Spain is also doing very good work. And then other many other countries, they are, you can say, pioneer in this type of technology and doing lots of protected cultivation. The Indian scenarios, as I told you, that relatively it's a new technology, and then the total area covered around 2016-17 was 30,000 hectare. The leading states, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Himachal, Northeastern State, Uttarakhand, Tamil Nadu, and Punjab. But nowadays, lots of cultivation have been going on in northern part of India. Eastern part of India is also coming up. Unfortunately, the crops covered in the protected cultivation are very limited. Almost around 10 to 12 crops, mostly the high-value horticulture crops, whether it is in the vegetable side, very popular crops are cucumber, tomato, cherry tomato, capsicum, melons. Now lots of greens like lettuce and all the green herbs, they are the new crops. And in the flower sector, we have rose, gerbera, carnation, chrysanthemum. They are the most popular crop, and then few of them are also there. And lots of government policies are going on to promote this technology, especially in the form of National Horticulture Mission, National Horticulture Board, RKVY, and then MIDH, through which the schemes related to subsidies have been popularized, and then they are being popularized throughout the country. And then many farmers are using this type of technology. NHM, RKVY, they are missed mostly for small farmers, small projects. NHB, they are funding very big projects in the, mainly in the area of, you can say, in the tune of about more than 1 crore, National Horticulture Board. So this is roughly the Indian scenario. As I told you that now, broadly it comes under the controlled environment agriculture, and you can see that if you see the data of 2021, there is a sudden jump, and you can say now the data says that approximately 1 lakh hectare has been reported of protected cultivation area. So there is a drastic improvement, and you can say increase in the area of protected cultivation area coverage. And many farmers are now coming to it and adopting it, which shows that the schemes and the technology is reaching to the farmers. You can see that in the picture, these are the broadly the structures that are being very commonly used by Indian farmers. Naturally ventilated greenhouse, in which there is no energy gadget. Most of this, this particular greenhouse is almost zero energy model. Then we have semi-climate type greenhouse, in which we do mostly cooling that is required in India, because in India most of the part summer is acute, and for the greenhouse climate, the Indian cold climate where the temperature is less than 0 degree, higher than 0 degree centigrade, is not a problematic. Once the temperature goes below 0 degree centigrade, then only we need heating. Otherwise, if the temperature is an around 0 degree centigrade, we do not need heating in the greenhouse, even in the what we have experienced at IRI also. Then climate controlled nursery, there are tunnels are there, insect proof net house is there. And you can see that this structure that I have discussed, that it's a structure which has to be designed properly by engineering principles. And the principles are mainly the height, the other very important principle is this ventilation required, what are the crops to be grown, what are the covering materials required, and mostly we use the galvanized iron pipes inside to construct the greenhouse. There are various standard designs of greenhouse and its roof type. So these are all very typical engineering structures in which lots of engineering initiatives are required still to improve the things structure. And then other important thing for this type of structure is very specialized covering materials, where we use, here we use specialized plastics. It should be UV stabilized, having should have particular thickness, nets, lots of insect proof net, shade net, silver net, black nets. So these are the covering materials which are very important things required for the design and installation of this particular structures. So some structure, most of these structure are a combination of plastics and nets, but in some structures we use only nets, suppose in insect proof net, it's a shade net in which we use only shade net. So each structure has its typical use for some particular conditions to grow particular crops. At IRI, these are the facilities that have been developed for the last about 20 years. That these centers, we have about 20 greenhouse now. Many crops we are using. Almost all the types of protected structures we have. Then major focus research areas now we are either production and protection technologies, IPM and GAP, vertical farming, automation. So these are the major focused areas. And then related to it, we have different institute and research externally funded projects are there, in which we have been working at Indian Agriculture Research Institute. As I told you that this structure is particularly owned by the farmers, naturally ventilated greenhouse. You can see in the picture, it's a 500 square meter, very simple structure. And outside it, there is a low pressure drip irrigation, which works almost on zero energy. So in this type of gravitation-based drip irrigation, you do not need any energy for working on it. In the tanks visible in the picture, in the same tank, we add water-soluble fertilizers. And then there is a valves and filters which when open and closed according to the crop demand. So you can see inside the greenhouse, we are taking in one portion tomato and in one portion colored capsicum. So this is a very common structure, and most of the farmers are using it in the different parts of the country for growing lots of horticulture crops. The problem is that this structure has limitation when you have extreme summer, then because there is no cooling inside it, then there is a problem. Otherwise, even in Delhi condition, 9 to 10 months, it works very satisfactorily. Then, as I told you, these are the few some latest designs that we have done, that greenhouse nursery, net house, and greenhouse. So in greenhouse, the design things, as I told you, how to maximize the ventilation. That is a very important thing. So there are all mathematical formulas and models are there to calculate the ventilation. Ventilation we required for the ventilation for top, ventilation from side. How to do the maximum ventilation and stabilize the structures. So this is one of the very guiding principle of design of structures. On the basis of it, we have designed different, these are the structures designed at IRI and then very commonly used by other stakeholders. Some advanced protected cultivation modules, which you can say that pure soilless cultivation, hydroponics, or nowadays vertical farming, in which we are taking the crops in multiple layers with the help of artificial light. So these are the latest research now that we are also doing. And fortunately, we have some very good project also to build this type of specialized vertical farming models, in which the major technology is basically soilless, hydroponics, and aeroponics. And then we have to use, of course, artificial light to grow the crop inside it. See, this is a very, very interesting slide. Please, you can see that this is the very innovative model that we have developed at our farm. You can see that in the entire 25-acre farm, all the water, especially the runoff water, being generated from the rooftop of the protected structures and our open field also. You can see in the background that from the greenhouse top, all the gutters are there, in which we have converted the connected into the lateral drains, and all the water, runoff water, which generated immediately after the runoff, because the greenhouse top is pure plastic. So immediately the runoff starts, even with few rains. And these all rains, we have we try to store the rainwater in different types of reservoir. You can see that there is a special reservoir that is the geomembrane lined reservoir. Then we have RCC reservoir. And also we have unlined reservoir used for groundwater recharge. So three models of water harvesting we have made. In the picture, there are two are visible. And then all the waters are, rainwater are coming into it. We are trying to collect the water and then reuse that water with modern irrigation method, whether it is sprinkler or drip. So this is the thing, that how we first collect the rainwater and then reuse that water. Many farmers are doing very good work on this line and doing good work to collect the water and reuse that water, making the protected cultivation module sustainable in terms of water. Then these are the some modern machines we are using for fertigation management. We have very specialized filtration machine, which can this particular spin clean disc filtration machine, if this can handle even a small river to clean the water, especially to get rid of major suspended impurities. And then we are using lots of fertigation controller for automation, especially to do the automation and control the fertigation of different parts of this. We have developed one indigenous irrigation scheduler also with the help of one DST project. We have taken the help of CDAC, Mohali, and then developed this particular indigenous irrigation controller. These are the machines mostly used for the automation and also for fertigation management in protected cultivation. Then, as I told you, that in automatic drip fertigation method, for we are using especially in all our farms, where there is a dedicated fertigation controller unit, and then specialized fertigation field layout, some solar power fertigation also we are doing, and try to use in collectively this model so that it helps in overall saving of water and saving of nutrient also in protected cultivation. What we have found that you can see that in this data, that there is a clear cut advantage that if you take a particular crop, say tomato, when you grow this crop in open field with surface irrigation, you get the crop water productivity only around 12 kilogram per meter cube. And you see, if you use same crop in the semi-climate controlled greenhouse with the drip irrigation, you can see there is almost 7 times increase. The crop water productivity goes 80 kilogram per meter cube. It is possible only that we get high production and use less water. So the productivity is yield per unit use of water. So when we have high yield and less water, there is a clear-cut jump. You can see that in the picture that this is only to show one particular crop that there is a clear-cut advantage of using greenhouse for increase the crop water productivity. Lot of sensors we are using for protected cultivation sensor, whether it is soil moisture sensor, fertigation sensor, climatic sensor, disease monitoring sensor, we have very few. Nutrition deficiency sensor, they are very costly, still we have to import. Food quality sensors are also costly. So mostly most of the sensors, you can see that some sensors are available in our country. They are cheap. They are being used now also by the growers, but not all. Many sensors are still very costly. And especially if you take the sensor and to be used in for automation, then sometimes the sensors are very, very costly.
Dr. Hassan, sorry to interrupt. Yes. Another couple of minutes, if you can.
Yes, wind up.
Thank you.
See now, we are evaluating different sensors for a greenhouse crop water productivity. You can see that, say, the crop is chrysanthemum, in which we evaluated the things. These are the grow bag and container soilless system-based greenhouse, in which in the greenhouse, we are taking the crops totally without soil. You can say that is the grow bag technology. So totally soilless media based technology. Then this is the latest research that we have designed the indigenous model of aeroponic system, in which the crops are being hanging in the air and we spray the crops, the water and nutrition. We have done its complete automation, and recently we have developed the IoT modules for it also. This is the pure hydroponic model. You can see that in which in pure water culture, we grow the crop. Some bulletins we have developed, especially for Hindi and English for the farmers also. And these are available free in Google. Some technical bulletins on hydroponics and all these things. Coming to the very important slide, that is the technological. What are the technological and policy issues required? See, what we required, indigenous models and designs as per the agroclimatic zones and farmers requirement. It is very necessary because in many parts of the country, there is still no standard designs being followed. So as an engineer, we require very concerted efforts to develop this type of models and designs. We need sensors, IoT and automation based greenhouse technology. Still, we are importing the things, and many projects are going on to develop these things. I hope that in the coming year, it will be more easily accessible. Then I have already told that we need vertical farming models linked with protected cultivation technology based on hydroponics as well as aeroponics. Demonstrations and trainings related to various experts are required by the farmers, because many farmers in many parts of the country, they require specialized trainings. Then finally, for the success of the models, what we have found in our experience that individually protected cultivation is not successful. They are successful only when we have the cluster approach and there are FPO-based business models. So these things are very important to have successful models as entrepreneurship development for the farmers. So whenever there is a cluster of things, we found that it is very good. And also the FPO, there are many FPOs are doing very good work. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Muntaza. I think next I'd like to invite Mr. Shunil Sharma. I would request Muntaza Hassan to also introduce Mr. Sunil.
Okay. Mr. Sunil Sharma, are you there?
Ji, namaste, sir.
Haan, namaste. Okay. It's really a privilege to introduce Mr. Sunil Sharma ji. I will introduce in Hindi. Mr. Sunil Sharma, ये जयपुर के रहने वाले हैं और इनका फार्म अलवर राजस्थान में है और ये लगभग 2007 से संरक्षित खेती दैट प्रोटेक्टेड कल्टीवेशन टेक्नोलॉजी कर रहे हैं और लगभग 2007-8 से ये IRI से जुटे हैं हम लोगों से और ये प्रोटेक्टेड कल्टीवेशन टेक्नोलॉजी में बहुत अच्छा काम कर रहे हैं। ये आज के डेट में एक एंटरप्रेन्योर भी हैं जो कि इन्होंने बहुत सारे मॉडल्स अपने बनाए हैं और ये संरक्षित खेती में होने वाले बहुत सारे फसलों पर काम कर रहे हैं। ये IRI के सक्सेसफुल फार्मर्स में इनका नाम है और अभी ये इन्होंने बहुत सारी मशीनरीज और टेक्नोलॉजीज प्रोटेक्टेड कल्टीवेशन टेक्नोलॉजी पर काम किए हैं। आप सभी को मैं चाहूंगा कि आप लोग कभी भी मौका मिले तो सुनील शर्मा जी का फार्म अलवर में वहां जाके आप इनका फार्म देख सकते हैं। अलवर के पास राजस्थान में बहुत सारे फार्मर्स बहुत अच्छी खेती कर रहे हैं और सुनील शर्मा साहब IRI से हम लोगों से बहुत दिन से जुटे हुए हैं और हम लोग कोशिश करते हैं कि इनको भी सिखाएं और हम लोग भी इनसे सीखें क्योंकि इन्होंने बहुत अच्छा काम किया है। तो मैं अगले कुछ मिनटों में सुनील शर्मा जी से रिक्वेस्ट करता हूं कि वो अपना एक्सपीरियंस शेयर करें। सुनील शर्मा जी प्लीज शेयर योर एक्सपीरियंस।
जी जी, सभी को मेरा नमस्कार। माफी चाहूंगा, मैं इंग्लिश में बात नहीं कर पाऊंगा, हिंदी में ही बोलूंगा।
प्लीज हिंदी में बोलिए,
कुछ प्रॉब्लम नहीं।
जी सर, मैं एक्चुअली 2007 से जुड़ा हुआ हूँ सर के साथ ना, IRI से, और प्रोटेक्टिव कल्टीवेशन में काफी काम किया है। मेरे पास बहुत सारा एक्सपीरियंस है इस फील्ड में। अब मेरे को समझ में नहीं आ रहा मैं कहाँ से स्टार्ट करूँ, आपको कहाँ से बताऊँ। मैंने काफी क्रॉप पे काम किया है और प्रोडक्शन भी काफी लिया है, कुछ प्रॉब्लम भी आई है उनको भी फेस किया है। और जैसे जहाँ से मैं रहता हूँ वहाँ पे क्या है कि क्लाइमेट कंडीशन जो है वो सपोर्ट नहीं करता फार्मर को। जैसे साउथ की जो फार्मर है उनको क्लाइमेट कंडीशन सपोर्ट करता है, वहाँ पे टेम्परेचर जो है वो नेचुरली 15 से 30 डिग्री के बीच में रहता है। लेकिन अलवर में जहाँ मेरा फार्म है वहाँ पे फ्लक्चुएशन बहुत ज्यादा है टेम्परेचर का। मतलब हम लोग, हेलो सर, आप सुन पा रहे
हैं? बताइए
जी। वहाँ पे सर फ्लक्चुएशन बहुत ज्यादा टेम्परेचर का होता है, तो उसकी वजह से क्या है कि हमें क्रॉप लेने में बड़ी दिक्कत आती है। पूरे साल क्रॉप लेने में नहीं ले पाते मोस्टली, क्या गर्मी के मौसम में दिक्कत आती है, फिर सर्दी में जब ठंड पड़ती है तो दिक्कत आती है कि टेम्परेचर कभी -4 डिग्री चला जाता है, कभी 48 डिग्री चला जाता है। तो उस पर भी हम लोगों ने काफी डिजाइन में काम किया है और डॉक्टर हसन के साथ हमने मिलकर डिजाइन थोड़ा चेंज किया है और नेचुरल वेंटिलेटेड में, क्यों गाँव के अंदर क्या लाइट की बड़ी प्रॉब्लम होती है, लाइट आती नहीं है, लाइट बहुत कम आती है, 5-6 घंटे लाइट देते हैं, कभी एक हफ्ते रात में देते हैं, एक हफ्ते दिन में देते हैं। तो फिर हमने सोलर का भी सिस्टम लगाया हुआ है और कुछ हमने चेंजेस किए हैं डिजाइन में चेंजेस करके, और हमने उसको एक सक्सेस प्रोडक्शन में काम किया है। काफी हमने पूरे 12 महीने हमने प्रोडक्शन लिया है अराउंड द ईयर, जिसमें से मई जून में भी हमने क्रॉप चलाई है। तो ऐसे काफी उस फील्ड में है और लेकिन अभी बहुत भी और भी कुछ काम करने की इसमें रिक्वायरमेंट है। अभी काफी स्कोप है इसमें और आगे भी नई नई टेक्नोलॉजी के साथ जुड़ के और काम कर सकते हैं। तो मैं समझता हूँ कि डॉक्टर साहब इसमें काफी अच्छा काम कर रहे हैं और जुड़े हुए हैं फार्मर के साथ में, टाइम पे लोग टच में रहते हैं, बताते भी हैं और हमारी जो प्रॉब्लम होती है उसको भी फेस करते हैं और समझते भी हैं, आगे गाइड भी करते हैं। तो ऐसे सब ठीक है, अभी तो कोई ऐसा है नहीं। और अगर आप कुछ पूछना चाहते हैं तो मैं,
नहीं आप ये बताइए आपने कौन कौन सा फसल लिया है, आपका क्या एक्सपीरियंस रहा है, कितना कम है
फसल? जी जी जी, फसल एक्चुअली में सर हम लोग टमाटर, कैप्सिकम और कुकुम्बर लिया है। लेकिन मैं जहाँ तक समझता हूँ कुकुम्बर का रेट ऑफ रिटर्न काफी अच्छा है, कि टमाटर और कैप्सिकम का जो साइकिल टाइम है वो करीबन 3 से 4 महीने बाद प्रोडक्शन चालू होता है और 8 महीने तक चलता है वो। और कुकुम्बर में क्या है कि जब सोइंग करते हैं उससे 35 डेज में उसका हार्वेस्टिंग चालू हो जाता है और उसका डिमांड के आसपास काफी अच्छा डिमांड रहता है कि उस सलाद में काम आता है और ओपन फील्ड में हो नहीं पाता, इसकी वजह से उसका रेट ठीक मिलता है। जो क्रॉप ओपन फील्ड में हो जाती है उसका रेट गिर जाता है, जैसे मंडी में जो ज्यादा क्रॉप आएगी तो उसका रेट कम हो जाता है। कई बार देखा है कि टमाटर का रेट 3-4 रुपए 2 रुपए किलो तक रेट आ जाता है, लेकिन कुकुम्बर जो वैरायटी ग्रीन हाउस में लगाते हैं वो वैरायटी ओपन फील्ड में नहीं हो पाती और उसकी वजह से उसका रेट हमें हर साल के एवरेज रेट अगर पकड़े तो 20 रुपए पर केजी का आसपास रेट मिल जाता है। और मैं समझता हूँ कि पर प्लांट हम लोगों ने प्रोडक्शन जो लिया है वो 3 से 4 केजी तक प्रोडक्शन हमने लिया है अभी तक, अगर उसको अच्छा मेंटेन करके चलाते हैं। सर्दी के मौसम में थोड़ा ज्यादा प्रोडक्शन आ जाता है, गर्मी में थोड़ा चलता है तो 3 kg से नीचे नहीं आता, 3 kg के आसपास प्रोडक्शन आ जाता है और एवरेज रेट 20 रुपए के हिसाब से लगाते हैं। तो मेरे पास अभी जो कवर्ड एरिया है लगभग 12,000 square meter कवर्ड एरिया है और उसके अंदर पर स्क्वायर मीटर के हिसाब से अगर देखते हैं तो 3 plants पर स्क्वायर मीटर में हम लोग लगाते हैं अभी। पिक्चर मैं वीडियो भी आपको दिखा सकता हूँ, मोबाइल में है तो अगर आप चाहें तो मैं आपको दिखा सकता हूँ वीडियो फोटो। और
क्योंकि उससे आइडिया लगेगा ना कि आपका सिस्टम कैसा है कैसे।
जी 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 सर, अगर आप देख पा रहे हैं
सुनील शर्मा जी।
जी सर।
हाँ हाँ, एक्चुअली अभी इस ग्रुप में बहुत सारे इंजीनियर्स जुटे हुए हैं, आप ये बताइए थोड़ा कि इसमें जो स्ट्रक्चर्स हैं और जो मशीनरीज है उसके बहुत अच्छे अच्छे एक्सपर्ट अभी बैठे हैं, पूरे वर्ल्ड के एक्सपर्ट बैठे हुए हैं, आप ये बताइए कि इसमें क्या क्या आपको लगता है कि और इंजीनियरिंग चीज आना चाहिए और क्या क्या मशीनरीज जो आपको लगता है कि इसमें प्रोटेक्टेड कल्टीवेशन में होना चाहिए, कुछ अगर आपका एक्सपीरियंस आप बताइए।
जी सर, प्रोटेक्टेड कल्टीवेशन में सबसे बड़ी प्रॉब्लम क्या आती है कि निमेटोड्स की सबसे ज्यादा प्रॉब्लम आती है, मतलब 2-3 साल के बाद हर ग्रीन हाउस में, मैंने जब तक देखा है ना, मोस्टली हर ग्रीन हाउस में निमेटोड की प्रॉब्लम आ जाती है और निमेटोड को खत्म करने के लिए केमिकल का उपयोग करना पड़ता है या फिर आप उसको आप हीट से अगर आप उसको करते हैं कवरिंग करके शीट्स लगा के ना गर्मी के मौसम में, तो थोड़ा बहुत इफेक्ट पड़ता है। हम लोग भी पहले मेटम सोडियम से सोइल को ट्रीट करते थे लेकिन उसका साइड इफेक्ट ज्यादा होता था कि केमिकल से जमीन भी खराब होती थी और फसल में भी इतना अच्छा नहीं रहता था रिजल्ट उसका। तो उसके बाद फिर हमने उसमें एक मशीन, मैंने एक मशीन बनाई थी उसको निमेटोड को किल करने के लिए और मैं आपको वीडियो दिखा सकता हूँ उसका कि मेरे पास चल रहा है ये और इसका अच्छा रिजल्ट आ रहा है अभी ना। इससे हम लोगों ने सोइल को 60 डिग्री टेम्परेचर तक हीट कर दिया और उसकी वजह से क्या कि निमेटोड सारा खत्म हो गया और उस एक क्रॉप में निमेटोड नहीं आता, कहीं थोड़ा बहुत जैसे रह जाता है तो वो अगली क्रॉप में दिखाई देता है, लेकिन ये इसका रिजल्ट काफ़ी अच्छा है। और इसमें भी डॉक्टर साहब से हमने काफ़ी सहयोग लिया, जैसे मशीन का डिजाइन कैसे चलाना है, कैसे बनाना है, कैसे इसको यूज करना है, उसमें काफ़ी सहयोग रहा है इनका। और अभी हम लोग, मैं करीबन ये मान लो 3 साल से इसको यूज कर रहा हूँ, 3 साल से पहले मैं केमिकल यूज करता था, उसके बाद मैंने केमिकल पूरा बंद कर दिया है, अभी मैं कोई केमिकल यूज नहीं करता और क्रॉप को इसी से फीड को ट्रीट करके और फिर हम लोग क्रॉप लगाते हैं, एक क्रॉप में मेरा निमेटोड नहीं आता बिल्कुल भी।
डॉक्टर मुर्तजा, इज इट पॉसिबल दैट वी कैन कॉल हिम आफ्टर नेक्स्ट सेशन विद वीडियोस एवरीथिंग, सो इट बी वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक टू नो द फील्ड।
Yes.
So able to understand. Probably, probably we can have it next week. We'll have CA, then we'll have your planning for UA. I think we'll call him with all the videos we prepare in advance. Then probably everybody will be able to view this properly.
Yeah. Yes. Sunil Sharma ji. Yes, sir. Sunil Sharma ji. आज तो वक्त थोड़ा कम है. अगले बार में हम लोग चाहेंगे कि आप भी सारा वीडियो, जितना फोटोग्राफ, उसका एक प्रेजेंटेशन हम आपको मदद करेंगे बनाने में. ठीक है ना? आप कर लेंगे. आज हम लोगों का जो प्रोग्राम था कि आपको सिर्फ हमने चाहते थे आपसे सुनना और अगले बार सब लोग आपको इतना अच्छा लग रहा है, सब लोग चाह रहे हैं कि आपका फार्म देखें, एक वर्चुअल टूर करा लेंगे आपके फार्म का, है ना?
बराबर, बराबर,
बराबर, बराबर, बराबर, और वो कर लेंगे वो अगले बार से। ठीक है, धन्यवाद।
ओके ओके, थैंक यू सर,
धन्यवाद, थैंक यू वेरी मच सुनील सर,
थैंक यू।
आई लाइक टू नाउ इनवाइट द नेक्स्ट स्पीकर। वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट स्ट्रक्चर्स, द इंजीनियर्स जॉब इज स्ट्रक्चर्स, इज वन ऑफ द इंजीनियर्स जॉब, and we have an expert in structures, especially in poly houses and protected cultivation, Dr. Sandeep Kumar Jain. He has had a PhD from JNKV Jabalpur, and he is M.Tech from IIT Kharagpur, B.Tech also from Jabalpur, and now right now he is in the Department of Farm Structure and College of Agricultural Engineering Technology, Dapoli. He has almost 30 research papers. He's written 2 books and he has got recommendations, 6 recommendations. And he has teaching experience of almost 20 years. And I have seen this protective cultivation is working on structures for last 3-4 years. I would request Sandeep Jain, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, sir. Shall I share my screen?
Yes, please.
Sir, is it visible?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Respected Gajan Singh sir, Sayed sir, and all honorable members of the group, good evening and welcome to all of you. The topic of my webinar is sustainable structures for protected cultivation. I am working in Konkan region in Dr. Balasaheb Sawan Konkan Krishi Vidyapeeth, which is blessed with a sea coast of 720 kilometers. Annual average rainfall is 3,500 mm to 4,000 mm. Huge numbers are here of the having small land holdings and comes under the category of small and marginal farmers. Wind speed is predominant, and also it is a cyclone prone area because in last 10 years, three cyclones have come over here having a speed of 85 km per hour to 140 km per hour. Out of the world's total bamboo grown area, the Asia contributes to 65% of the bamboo cultivation. And out of that, 30% contribution is from India. And out of that, Maharashtra is having 10%. Bamboo is grown abundantly in Konkan region. Actually, bamboo is a renewable and very strong grass, having good strength and flexibility. But the problem with bamboo is it is attacked by fungus, beetles, termites, borers, and hence it needs to be protected. Otherwise, within less than 1 year, it gets decayed and its strength gets loosened. Though it is not, it has very good tensile strength, but though steel is having 6 times more tensile strength, but it can be used for the rural housing and other structures. Regarding chemical treatment, as per the IS code, these are the chemicals and their proportions which are given by them. For the outdoor application, copper, chrome, boron, the fourth one is very useful. It is not very costly also and having good effect on that. In the earlier methods of preservation of bamboo, the traditional method for the sap removal is to keep the bundle of bamboo in the flowing river. Also, bamboo can be kept standing in the chemical so that they can suck the chemical. And nowadays, about 8 to 10 lakh rupees machine is also available, mobile pressure plant, in which within 6 to 8 hours, 100 bamboos can be treated. Before, we have developed one this small machine which can treat 6 bamboos at a time of any length. These are the joints. And 1.5 kg per centimeter square pressure is required. And it requires a time up to within three to five hours. As soon as from the other end, the chemical starts dripping, it means the chemical treatment process is over. For the small farmers, such type of an oil drum can be cut vertically and joined horizontally, in which 4 meter long bamboos can be treated. To enhance the process, we can give the heat through the electric heaters up to 70 degrees centigrade, and it takes around time of 8 days. Before dipping in the drum or in some trench, we have to first of all drill it by a 3 mm drill. Below and above, that is both sides of the internodes. Of each and every internode, we have to drill so that the chemical can reach in the each curve. And this is the CCB solution, copper, chrome, boron solution. Earlier, we used to purchase the different three chemicals and then mix them. But now it is readily available with a person, entrepreneur in Pune, in a ratio 1:10. It is mixed with water, and in such type some sort of a trench we can use, which is plastic covered, and large quantity of bamboos can be submerged in that for about 8 days. And in this way, the treatment can be done. After treatment, the life of the bamboo increases from 10 to 30 years. Then the properties of the bamboos, of the bamboo which are available in the abundantly in Konkan, like Dendrocalamus strictus, Dendrocalamus stoxi, and Bambusa bamboos, we have found out the different properties of that, like compression strength, shear strength, fracture behavior of that was studied, then shrinkage was studied, the flexural strength was studied, and after that, based on this whole study, we have developed the design and developed the bamboo poly houses, which is of about 8 meter by 24 meter and having central height of 4.8 meters. The eave height was 3 meter and the foundation was kept only 0.5 meter. This is the isometric view of that. Here it is the picture of that. And the foundation, for the foundation, the bamboo was embedded in a plastic pipe and with the help of cement mortar, it has been fixed in the soil. And in this way, it was able to withstand the wind loads. Dead load, wind load, and live loads all were considered and the design was made according to that. It is very easy to work with bamboo as compared to the GI pipes. Cost also reduces by 20%. And rest of the things like plastic, zigzag spring, etc., that are common in that. Then two poly houses were made of the bamboo. One was covered with clear polyfilm having 200 micron thickness, and other was with diffused polyfilm having the same thickness, same area of 8 by 24 square meter. And we have grown, means actually temperature, humidity, and light intensity was observed at 9 places in the this thing. After that, we have grown cucumber in that, and it was found that in the diffused polyfilm, because the sunlight reaches to the lower portion of the plant, higher temperature was observed, higher light intensity was observed, and also cucumber yield was 18.9% higher than that of the clear polyfilm. These are a few pictures. Then on the basis of that, bamboo shed net houses were developed and given to the horticulture department. One workshop was also arranged on this, and few trainings were done for the farmers to teach them how to make the joints of bamboo, how to treat them. After that, in the same line, university has provided some funds to erect the bamboo houses to to promote the agro-tourism, and the farmer can grow this thing, bamboo houses in their fields as per their capacity, and it was done fully by our department. The exterior structure took about, for a bamboo house of 650 square feet, the cost was come to 5 lakhs. And for the interior furniture, which is made up of all these things, cane furniture was there. It came around 1,50,000. So total expenditure per unit area was 1,000 square feet. After successfully completion of this one bamboo house, 3 more bamboo houses were erected and given to the university authorities. This is the internal view of the bamboo house. This is of 200 square feet having roof shape of sawtooth type. Another was a 4-side leaning roof of 300 square feet. Then one bamboo house of 400 square feet was erected. Then some work was carried out on the colored shed nets. For that, mini plots of size 3 meter by 1 meter by and height 1.5 meter were prepared, and in which the colors of the shed nets were red, white, green, silver, black, and control was there in the open field. And in that, we have grown 3 crops in the pot only, tulsi, radish, and capsicum. We have found in the red, red shed net, it has given better results regarding temperature, humidity, and humidity was not having much effect, but regarding light intensity, it was having good results. Here we can see that for the Tulsi, maximum number of secondary and tertiary branches were obtained under the red shed net, having highest number of leaves also as compared to the other shed nets. Then for reddish, we got better results in silver, having more weight, and it was followed by the red one. Then for capsicum, the red shed net has given good results, and it was followed by the silver shed net. In other things, either the height was more, but fruiting was not there. Then with the help of the Sayed sir, and funded by ASPI, an automatic side curtain mechanism of naturally ventilated greenhouse was developed. It is said that in Konkan, it is a naturally greenhouse conditions are there, and that's why mechanical devices are not required. And hence, for naturally ventilated conditions, we used to open and the side curtains in the morning and close them in the evening. But during daytime also, the weather changes. And that's why for precise farming, this project was undertaken. So that, but farmer won't able to do this continuously in daytime. And hence, such type of arrangement was made with the help of roller pipes and motor and microcontroller. So that the microcontroller gives the signals, takes signals from the sensor, which can give the temperature reading in such a way that the optimum temperature range required for the crop is set in that of 28 degree centigrade to 32 degree centigrade. And when it reaches the 32 degree centigrade, it will open the door. And when it will reach 28 degree centigrade temperature, then it will again close the side curtains. On both the longer sides, the curtains were closed and opened simultaneously. The mechanical system was developed with the help of this bevel gears and roller pipes. And here is the microcontroller which senses, and also it gives on the from internet also. The arrangement was made by Sayed sir that from internet also we can take on our mobile.
Dr. Sandeep, can you wind up fast, a little bit fast? Yes. We are running out of time. For
Telnet app. And here is the video of that. Shall I show it?
We have less time.
Okay. Then other technologies which are developed by the department was making of the bamboo vinegar and charcoal. Then from the lateritic stone scrap, which is obtained from the quarries of lateritic stone, it has been recommended. Then concrete floor and rubber mat floor has given different effects, about 14% hike in milk production, and also comfort in sitting and standing of the cow. Then on bamboo mat board work was carried out. Then in early 2002, on Arecanut coconut harvester, the work was carried out, which is having from the ground control, we can harvest this thing. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Sandeep. It's very interesting to see with the bamboo, you can make polyhouse structures. And I think you told me about 20% of price is really reduced. But I think not using a steel and using a bamboo gives much more value for that. We'll come to that. I think we are getting short of time. So I'll invite the next speaker, who is a farmer. Dr. Sandeep, can you please close down?
Okay. Yes, sir. Thank you.
I'd like to introduce Mr. Ajay Singh. He's an agriculture engineering graduate, and he's got 32+ experience years in farm machinery sales and service. He has also worked with telecom networks, he has worked in life insurance, fresh food retail, hospitality, then farming. Identifying problems, finding actionable solutions, and executing to launch new projects. He is as a farmer at heart and in action. He has worked, like he told, Escorts, Alcatel, Bajaj Alliance, Tata, all the places. And I think he's working right now with urban agriculture. I'd like to invite Mr. Ajay Singh, please. Mr. Ajay Singh?
Yeah, good evening, good afternoon, good morning, please, whatever it is.
I request you, please try to make it in 10-12 minutes so we have discussion.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I believe everyone can see that.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah. So this is our organization called Nature Bins. And thanks to Corona last year, we launched this company as during the lockdown, the only three things we're selling, which were milk, fruits and vegetables, and medicines. So we had to pick up one business which was Corona proof and pandemic proof. So how we went about it? So this is our simple index where I'll be giving you my vision, mission, strategy, where we are today, where do we want to be in 365 days, farm fresh ideas, learning and business opportunities. Everyone is saying farm to fork, farm to whatever. We say soil to soul. To become a model farm to table value chain, which can be replicated and bring prosperity to farmers and fresh food to consumers. As you can see, unorganized has been marked very well. Un and D have gone out, so we'll organize this perishable food chain. To create a self-sustainable farming business, like what we are doing, we have taken a 22.5-acre farm near Wada in District Palghar, 110 kilometers away from Mumbai. So there we started, we have taken this farm on lease, and there we started working since November. The video forward will show the development. The second thing we are working on to B2C, like going to the consumer directly. So this is our target in 500 days. Currently, we are only doing wholesale and institutional sale. We will also add value in fresh produce by processing and marketing it digitally. We'll not go to the normal brick mortar market model. We'll only do it digitally. Now, backward integration in production, nursery, seeds, tissue culture, get high yielding varieties of fruits. This is our 3-year target. To replicate the model at other geographies, like we started in Mumbai, we will be coming in Solapur, we'll be coming in Greater Noida, we are coming in Pilibhit in next 6 months. So that would be, we'll be doing the same, replicate this particular model at 7 units in next 500 days and 20 units in 1,000 days. As our friend from Alwar, he told us that cucumber is the crop. We have done everything, but cucumber, we are going bullish. And this would be only crop throughout the year, because it works like a share market. We don't get the price every time, in winters we get less, in summers we get more. So we have decided that throughout the year, we'll only do cucumber at all the 30,000 square meters. We'll also do aggregation of onion, garlic, ginger, and yam. So these are products available with nearby farmers and nearby mandis. What we do, we trade with modern retail, that is Reliance and Tata, Horeca, that is, again, Taj and ITC. And we do wholesale in all the small mandis in small parts like Borivali, Kandivali, and anything on western side of Mumbai. Retail will start in a few months. That would be around Dashera time. We are developing a branded cart which will sell the product. Food processing, as you know, pickles, condiments, herbs through digital marketplace. Milk also, dairy we are developing, which is coming, and we'll only do it in few, because it is about 300 to 500 liters a day. So we are only doing it in 2 pin codes of Mumbai, where I live and where my partners live. Because of the dairy, we'll get into vermicompost, and again, this will go through the digital marketplace. So what we did in last 6 months, about 190 days, we refurbished 2 acres of poly houses and 5.5 acres of shade net. rejuvenated 7.5 acres of fruit orchards and refurbished 15-acre land parcel for drip irrigation system. Refurbished 3-acre polyhouse and shade net, misting and fogger system. Have completed crop cycles of cucumber, muskmelon and watermelon. We did 120 tons. And capsicum, okra, green chili growth cycle completed, harvesting ongoing. This would be 30,000 kgs we have done and 45,000 kgs in 60 days. Where we are today, sales and market, vendor registrations and all those, wherever the, because end of the day, whatever we produce, we are doing 60 tons per acre of cucumber now. And it has to sell. So even if we get, like in Delhi, we are getting 20 bucks, but in Mumbai, we are only getting 10, 12. So on an average, in 3 months, 1 acre gives us 6 lakhs worth of revenue. So we have registered 189 retailers, 145 farmers, and wholesale points at Vapi, Goti, Borivali, Goregaon, and Vashi operational. Technology, what we are doing is, because we are big farmers for our nearby area, so B2B app for farmer we are developing in 30 days with ERP, so that we can help that small farmer nearby in getting his produce sold. Website framework ready with content, we'll host it in 30 days. Payment gateways are already in place. Marketplace app ready for B2C will be launched in 15 days for limited customers by invitation, as I told, for dairy and for vegetables in 2 pin codes of Mumbai. Financials, what we have done till now, 1.56 crores we invested, October 2020 till date, and all this work was done. OPEX was 30 lakhs for these 6 months. Out of that, the startup cost, that is when the project was being refurbished, so we had to pay all the operational cost of salaries and transportation, so that is gone. So we made losses in about 3 lakh rupees, but I would say if I take the startup cost in CapEx, then it would become a 6 lakh rupees profit. 7 acres, 2.5, what is 365 day target. So 7 acres, average 2.5 crop cycles of 40,000 kg each, which is the minimum because we are already touching 55 tons. So this is 7 lakh kg yield per year. Dairy operation 1,000 liters a day. OPEX is around 4 lakh rupees a month. So operational profit will make about 22 lakhs in 365 days. Own production plus aggregation, which again, these are the numbers which are targeting, and we would do it for sure. Farm fresh ideas, like we are not good in everything. We have certain core competencies, like me, I'm a very competent person when it comes to sales. So the other partner who looks after the operation, the third partner who looks after the finances. So what we are doing, because we have got a land, it's a 150 acre total land parcel, out of which we are working in a 22 and a half acres. So we have collaborated with a dairy farmer who will take care of operations. So we'll buy milk from him. Rest of the things are his job. We are also collaborating with a mushroom farmer couple who will do the mushroom farming. All things done by them will pick up the material on a predefined cost. We are also collaborating with homemakers who will go there, make achar, chutney, and whatever. We'll get them all the desired, you know, packing, packaging, and selling the product online. I'll just share a small video. So what have been the learnings? I mean, I will share this slide with you, but what we have seen, the marginal farmer is barely surviving and unable to meet ends. With technology inputs in agri domain, challenge is execution. Either the technology is too costly, or you know, big farmers and like entrepreneurs of large size, they can afford to take that risk. But a smaller farmer, these technologies are not reaching. Human intervention will not go, like even if we do all AIs and whatnot, human intervention, because this, the total supply chain from harvest site to the consumer, this would require multiple changes. We can reduce the numbers of people involved, but we cannot you know, finish this chain. B2C, business to consumer, is matured, but it is discount driven. All the companies working on this line are losing money, they are burning money. Small FNV retail, we have studied about 800 odd retailers who are doing 200 to 500 kgs a day. They are making money. If they are given a support of good supply chain at their doorstep, they will make more money and we'll also make money. Follow the leader in the business, piggyback, copy shamelessly. What we have learned from my previous job and wherever, anything which is done good by Reliance, anything done by Ninja Cart, anything done well by, you know, Big Basket, we copy shamelessly, only the good things. Create a bottom heavy business, more workers than managers. Most of the companies are losing money because there are too many planners, very less executors. Business opportunities are executing micro input help collection, like small farmer associations and FPOs. This 365 days, we will be part of few FPOs, and God willing, we will making one FPO. Now this, when this comes to, you know, right from as sir mentioned, the cost of science, the cost of technology is high because it is sunk. So never, unless the total chain becomes entrepreneur, it is not going to reach the last man. So mini hub and microscope, which we have defined, mini hub, we have taken at Bhiwandi. There we are processing about 80 tons a day. And the microscope is a place where we do 8 to 10 tons of collection and aggregation. Scalability through participation of educated youth in village franchisees. We are developing the supply side franchisee instead of sales side supply franchisee. Storage and transportation. Right now we are outsourcing everything what we want. Like we are aggregating most of the, as I told you, onion, this thing, garlic, ginger, and yam. So all these things, they don't require much of a cold chain environment. The ambient we are doing. Refrigerated and frozen will go in 500 days. Food processing during peak production, like sometimes it would be green peas, sometimes it would be like cucumber, sometimes it would be capsicum. Wherever there is a peak production, we'll manage the food processing during that time. Consumer sales through invitation, retail mobile e-rickshaw carts, we are launching in Dashaira. Agri-tourism, as I just got the idea from this bamboo thing, that we can also have this as a structure. The final film for you. That's all from my side, sir.
Thank you, Ajay Singh. It's very interesting. We saw that, yes, the urban agriculture has come to business level now. We have a lot of hopes. I think we have been discussing about this for some time, whether it's possible, whether it'll accept. I think 3 lakhs loss, he told, converted back again to CapEx of 6 lakhs. I asked him to share his financials, ROI details. Beginning, he was hesitant, but I think it's very important for rest of us to know practically the financials, because everybody says it's expensive. So I think it's excellent. Now I put the floor for the questions. I see, raise the hand if it's good, or I will put the this one to view into the gallery view, so you can show the hand also. First, I see Atul is asking. Atul, can you please ask your question?
Sir.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, can we see
sir,
you?
My question is... Yeah, just a minute, sir, because of...
okay, go ahead.
I'm very thankful to you for organizing such nice seminar for
skip that. Ask the question, please. We don't have time.
I'm asking, my question is for Mr. Hassan, Dr. Hassan from IRI.
Yes, go ahead.
Hello.
Shoot the question, please.
Yeah, I'm asking, sir. Yeah, my question is, what we observe is the high protective, high controlled protective structures are not still penetrating, particularly in a low sunlight area like a coastal region. No doubt in Maharashtra near some Pune or somewhere in Nasik, the greenhouse are coming up as a business, but still it is during the low sunlight area. The productivity is drastically reduced, as there is a no sir. As far as the data available, around 6 months are under the light saturation point of the crop productivity for the photosynthesis process. Is there any advancement is takes place at premium institute like ACR or IRI regarding in this area? Yes. Particularly questions to Dr. Hassan, sir.
Yeah, what we have observed that in northern part of India, we have enough sunshine, and even in the winter part here, where the sunlight duration is very less, but from the protected cultivation technology, there is enough sunlight and there is enough photosynthesis. Once we go for multi-layered farming, then only the light is issue. But you are right that what the farmer should do. See, what the farmer should do that, especially in the place where you have lots of dust and pollution, then regular washing and maintenance of structures, especially the films that required, especially in the winter season, one or two washing of top and sides of the plastics, because the dust accumulates. And also on the insect-proof net, we can go for some pressurized washing that it helps in better penetration of sunlight. But otherwise, in most part of India, sunlight is not the issue. And fortunately, our country is blessed with very good sunlight in most part of the place.
Okay.
Yeah.
Next, anybody else? Dr. Vinay Singh, please.
Can you hear me?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
First of all, I'd like to congratulate all the 4 speakers. I think they did a very good job. Murtuja, I think one of the question still is on the plastics in terms of quality of plastic from a strength point of view.
Yes, sir.
And durability.
Yes.
Because it is subjected to very high temperatures in summer and cold in winter. So I think the IIT has a big project with ICR. And I think we should work with the IIT. Indramani can probably take a lead at IRI level to work on the sensors and all those things. Because sensors, you said that they are very expensive, you are importing. So I think in this area, we should really work on the partnership. For Sandeep, I think there is a very big project on bamboo mission. Are you getting any funding from bamboo mission?
No, sir. I don't have any fundings. Actually, small projects.
No, you should try to find out more detail about bamboo mission. It's a huge mission of the government of India. Yes. And they provide, especially you are working with the small farmers and all that, and this is an ideal project for bamboo mission. Okay.
Yes, sir.
I think I'll stop here, but I'd like to hear sometime Dr. Brahm Singh and also Dr. Jit Srivastav, their comments sometime.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir, you are very right, sir. Especially the covering materials and the automation part, all these things are very important. And then many projects are going on for, and Dr. Indramani, sir, and today, now he is leading in the, our center also at Center for Protected Cultivation Technology. And then we got now a very big project funded by Department of Science and Technology, in which two German institutes are the partner. They are expertise in sensors and automations. And together we shall work and develop some modules. Yes.
I hear a hand raised, Ranjit Kumar. Then I will give it to Dr. Indramani. Ranjit Kumar, your question.
Oh, yes, sir. Hi, good evening. I would like to know whether this protected cultivation in organic method, is it possible? Have you done any work and any feasibility on this part?
Yeah, I think you are right that this technology, although it is, we are using lots of chemical fertilizers and IPM modules, but recently, now you must have heard there is a very popular farmer, Mr. Sepat, in Jobner district of Rajasthan. Recently, he got a very big ICR award on ICR Foundation Day. His work is totally towards making the protected cultivation organic and also linked with protected with water harvesting and all these things. So, works are going on, but limited. Still, the protected cultivation is full of, we are using lots of water-soluble fertilizers, chemicals.
True.
We are using.
Okay. That's great.
Thank
second
you.
Thing, second thing, one more question I would like to have. How can we see that Alwar form of Mr. Sharma?
We'll see. Next program, we will invite him sure. with the videos, everything, the form. That's
thank
what,
you.
We'll do, because it's... now I would like to invite Dr. Indramani to say a few words.
Very briefly, actually, Professor Singh's concern is very important, and even at IRI, we got these greenhouses in 1995 around, and they are more than 25 years old. 25 hectare land, 25 more than 25 years old, and there is need actually. And different aspects, including covering material and processing, rightly said about the sensor, etc. We have a big program with IIT Delhi. It is going to start, and that is ICR level, in which all these amount and this sensor development is also there in that program, that is on precision agriculture. Another big program which we are going to initiate, we have already initiated, is that one, DST Indo-German project, and that is a big program, big funding, and we are going to, have this is basically an automation aspect, and we will try to develop. So, question up, my friend, that why it is not, this sensor and other things are not penetrating to different parts of country. So probably that will become possible, and then we have started, sir. We have going to sign an MOU with. Jain Irrigation Group, a high-level discussion has been held at both IRI and Jain Irrigation have agreed to work together. And in that also, in IRI, we have had a separate mango farm and one or two other locations where all technologies which Jain Group is having and IRI expertise, both together, because as you say always, that until unless industry join hand and entrepreneurs like Ajit join hand, the technology will not. So two, three major developments are there. Regarding that Sharma ji, which raised the point, the problem of nematode and then Another point was raised about organic aspect of greenhouse cultivation. So recently, under NASF project, sir, we have been asked to, in one project which already has been approved, this will go as a component for nematode control and all basically pest management, complete pest management, and that too through organic base, so that the concept that in greenhouse we are getting almost organic food. Because recently we had one Jayant Sinha, he came to our center and Murtaza was there, and he just picked one tomato and just wash it and eat there only. And then we said that, and my director was also there, and we said that a minister level person has this concept that in green we are cultivating without any use of pesticide, etc. So that's one big, this is a big issue, and that is a major menace, nematodes in Rajasthan, in Himachal, in Madhya Pradesh. So if this is, Dr. H.S. Gupta himself initiated that, get one, component for this IPM pest management, and farmers field, and farmers level, that is one good step is going to there. And Ajay has given this one good start, which is going to industry. Probably we have to see that after a few years, he should give feedback. Actually, how it is progressing, so that we can have this. But this technology is future of agriculture, sir. But lot of you might have gone to your village. I go to Haryana. Many people started, many farmers started with subsidy, and in 1 or 2 years they just threw out. So that is one thing we have to see how to make it. That's very important. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Indramani. I heard about for nematode. I think one of my classmates is using ozone. I don't know much about it. We'll come back afterwards. I would like to hear from Dr. Jitendra Srivastava. Few words.
Sorry, sir. मैं कुछ कहना चाह रहा था. अगर आप allow करें तो.
शर्मा जी हाँ.
हाँ जी. Okay.
सर, अभी covering material की जो बात चल रही थी ना, सर मैंने face किया है कि जो covering material में जो sheet लगती है ना greenhouse पे, वो sheet हमारी 3 से 4 साल से ज़्यादा नहीं चलती. लेकिन रिसेंटली मैंने पॉलीकार्बोनेट की शीट एक यूज की है. अभी मई जून में हमने एक प्रोजेक्ट लगाया था झुंझुनू में. मैं उसका वीडियो भी आपको शेयर कर सकता हूँ. ये हमने पूरा उस पर लगाया है पॉली हाइड्रोपोनिक पे, और इसका काफी अच्छा रिजल्ट आया है. और अभी ये क्रॉप देखो आप, देखने को आपको मिलेगी.
वो नेक्स्ट टाइम देखिएगा, वो सब वीडियो नेक्स्ट टाइम देखिएगा प्लीज, बिकॉज अभी क्लियर नहीं सबका देखने के लिए.
जी जी जी,
नेक्स्ट टाइम देखिएगा.
आप पॉलीकार्बोनेट का यूज कर सकते हैं शीट के अलावा, शीट के जगह पे ना, उसका काफी अच्छा रिजल्ट है.
थैंक यू डॉक्टर जितेंद्र श्रीवास्तव प्लीज.
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वांट टू कांग्रेचुलेट, दिस इज वन ऑफ द बेस्ट प्रेजेंटेशन वेयर यू हैड डिफरेंट स्टेक होल्डर्स फ्रॉम रिसर्चर्स टू द फार्मर्स एंड द प्राइवेट सेक्टर दैट आई हर्ड फ्रॉम मिस्टर अजय. Made me feel very happy and proud that the technology is there, interest is there. However, I have been watching India's agriculture since 1965 and was involved in a number of World Bank supported projects, even NATP and all those kind of things. I would urge you to go a little bit one step. Research is important. And Dr. Murtaza, you gave a very good one. As a matter of fact, I had gone to see the and supported Israeli-Indo cooperation in Karnal, and had the Minister of Haryana Agriculture come and support it in Washington to support this kind of activities. But that there was not much taking from India. What I would say that it is, actually, I would urge Dr. Murtaza and IRI. I talked to RB and Raj Parada as well when I was there last time. I wanted to meet you people because I believe the future with less water or land that you all have said, and this kind of agriculture is absolutely necessary and requires all the support, no doubt. You have given the details. Point I'm making just for in a short period is, please organize a bit of economics of it. Unless the economics is there, researchers can shout, talk every day, but it will not go anywhere. I was very here, farmers, and I would urge that after this talk, if you can, instead of generally doing it, because you are all engineers, I am happy with the technology. I am associated with the Aero Farms people. I visit in US, in Nevada, where all this is happening. But today, you give me enormous happiness with what I heard. I congratulate. Point I would like to say, if a small group like yours could put about 3, 4, 5 pages of the potential, the economics, how to promote greater adoption, what is needs to be done by the government and others, as those things would be extremely important. On March 55th, I'm on the invitation of Dr. Neeru Bhushan from IEARI. I had given a talk on some of this point slowly, but I would simply say it is one of the best. You brought everybody, not only the researcher, but everyone. There is a lot of scope, but may I urge you to take a leadership in writing a good concept note, what needs to be done by promoting it. Don't forget the green revolution with wheat and all that, that I was associated, unless we started Jawahar Jayanti Village on farm demonstrations all over, that would have not gone anywhere. I would urge you have a beautiful thing. This is absolutely necessary. Together, if you can come up, there'll be no shortage of funding and support. But it must be well thought out, a very good food system complementation to the conventional agriculture. Thank you very much. I'll be very happy to be talking to you guys later, but you made my day. I'm very happy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jitendra. I will
your guidance on this concept.
Oh, I just only added, I want to add Dr. Murtaza and Dr. Mani. When I was about 2 years ago, I came to IRI, and then I asked this question to people, and one Dr. Alka Singh from the economics department, I asked her to arrange a meeting with you guys, but I wanted to know, but apparently she could not arrange a meeting, otherwise I wanted to see you.
You are too high an official, in a way, position. They don't allow you to meet the real workers on the ground level. This is our Indian system. I've been part of it.
Okay, yes, so. I think
we would love to excellent
suggestions. I think I really feel grateful to you all to give the suggestion, and especially I have my guru and guru's guru, and I think what we have, when you take this step of combining conservation agriculture and urban agriculture, it was idea actually of Dr. Gajendra Singh. We're discussing in our group, and the ideas came, and it hit me like we are going to keep it till the end. So we plan already for about 5 sessions each. That's my planning of 5 sessions each. And then we will make a like we told white note. Already we received from Dr. Deshpande, also from US. I received a mail to him and invite. And I think Dr. Gajendra Singh, I leave it to him. After a few sessions, we'll get more people. And we'll have, like you told, we'll involve the entrepreneurs, industry, and scientists, and try to see to change how the Indian agriculture right now goes.
Dr. Ismail, the only request I will have to this group is, at this work that is going at, if IRI can, along with the private sector and the farmers, and Dr. Gajendra Singh's guidance, could come up with a what is required to popularize this technology, particularly in the drier areas, more difficult soils which are not there. I would say the this can catch up very fast. But it is requires the overall combination. And not only we can just talk, there are plenty of talk shops all over the world. I am urging and requesting to put the few ideas which can catch the attention of politicians, the policymakers, some funding, and you all require the kind of special funding to take this technology to the farmers and involve the youth, the private enterprise.
Yes, CAE Bhopal is another option.
We could have Dr. Brahm Singh also to join us if he is still there. He left.
He was there, Dr. Vinay Singh. He left?
Oh.
Yeah. He's not. I was about to call him. Yes. I think CAE Bhopal is one more option with IRA together, probably because they have got a network throughout India, CAE Bhopal. And that's one of the things where last talk, we invited the also CR Mehta to come and give a talk. Dr. Gajan Singh, please concluding marks.
No, I'm okay. I only thing wanted to say about Ajay. I think his project is extremely useful for small farmers. And if the FPOs, which are all over the country now coming up, if he can really energize FPOs and make a business with them. So it's the biggest challenge is how to organize FPO, how to bring farmers together with some motivation. And I don't know what kind of social worker we need to organize farmers. Otherwise, the way he can arrange with the soil to soil project, I think that's extremely good, but we need social scientists somehow to work on that one.
Anybody else want to?
Maybe Ajay will like to say something. What kind of difficulty he has?
The only thing which, the business makes sense, the economics and everything, research and the end user whom we want to target. Today, like we could afford that we had the backup of finances and we did this project in a different manner. But if I see a farmer like me working in a place like Gajipur, I was discussing with Mishra sir, that if I have to start all over again as a 1 hectare farmer, how I'll do it differently and what challenges I'll face there. Luckily, we are doing it near Mumbai or Delhi. So we have the ready-made market. But there it would be difficult because it would be Varanasi, Lucknow, Kanpur.
I think Indramani has to tell secrets about him now. you have some secrets about him.
Sir is my 4 year senior, so he is the first one I touched feet.
We had a long discussion one day after last presentation, that is a year. And he is very dynamic person. And whatever, I feel that 2-3 more years, if he put and give his experience, then it will be really very much useful for the, we would like in this kind of venture, we would like to have, integrators like him who can involve farmers and, take. And see near Rajasthan, near Jaipur, there is a cluster of around 300 greenhouses, And one farmer, he was taken to, and Professor Jitendra Srivastavaji, he was taken to, Israel, and from there he took training. He got so much encouragement. He started one. Now there is a cluster of 300 plus greenhouses, and they are very, very happy. And they came to us in IRI, and they wanted. We have developed another technology, sir, which is Farm Sun Fridge, 100% solar based, gridless, battery less, in which 2-ton fruits and vegetables can be stored. And that government of India is encouraging it very well. And those farmers came that we want it immediately because they want, they can store that fruits and vegetables for 2-3 days, there, and then take to the market. The thing which you are suggesting, that how to connect to the market. And similarly, they suggested that such a structure should be there in the mandi also, that if I'm selling, I'm a seller, and if by the evening I have not sold my fruits and vegetables completely. I can store. I should not sell them at throwaway prices. So that kind of research efforts are going on, and we at IRA, under the guidance of Professor Singh, we are trying to connect, you know, all these, you know, stakeholders, starting from production catchment to sale area to these technologies. And Butte, your suggestion is very, very important. And I wrote Murtaza, my colleague, that let us prepare this one, and we will share with Professor Singh, and then we'll take your guidance also. Then 5-6 page paper, that is very, very important thing. I too feel actually sad when I go to my villages in Sajjar and other place. They got subsidy, they got it installed. In 3 years, there is nothing. So they are also not. So Professor Singh always says that this subsidy is one which is enemy of the technology.
Yes, I agree.
So, if it is not done properly. So there's so many things, sir, and we will need your advice and guidance.
I think we'll continue. Go on talking like this.
It's a simple thing, sir. This has to be a business.
Last year we covered in our series of subsidy, and I'm telling you, last year we did an excellent on solar pumping.
Yeah.
After so much of thing, 20 lakh solar pumps supposed to be installed, it's almost stopped.
Yeah.
Because the drawbacks of too much water pumping. This, I think our group has done it, because before that, instantly there were a lot of talks, and afterwards we had several, I think we had also had about almost 2,000 people attending last year webinar. I think Indramani, we can do this time also. This time we have taken a selective group of people because we want to see focus the topics and focus even presenters. That's what I told the presenters, should present within 15 minutes, 10 minutes maximum, because we can have more time for discussion. Actually, we are looking for people who can join in different parts, and because together we can solve the problems rather than one specialist only sitting there. Brahma Singh was there, was very good. And I invited from people from agriculture, entomologists, a lot of people I have invited. Unfortunately, it takes time for them to come into it, because only engineers cannot do it, like Jesus was told. And economics is very important. We forced already Ajay Singh to tell his financials. I'm also a businessman, so I look at first the money. I mean, if I want to lose also, I want to know where I want to throw my salt in the sea also. I measure and do it. And I think it's... very important. I think FP was a good suggestion, what the Dr. Singh told. We'll have one for actually the policies making. We'll have it in the last. Let us learn more from, please help me to get more farmers. I think Ajay, you have to help. Maybe you're a competitive farmer, but I think we all have to get more farmers view I want inside. Scientists we can pick up. I think we know most of them. Please help me. I think we'll close it today, unless somebody wants to say something, because we'll again start next week. Every Saturday we have.
Very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Sayyed.
It was everybody. My pleasure, and I would like to hear more.
Thanks for this your encouragement.
As a retiree now from here and looking at the global perspective, this is my passion these days. I think this is something has to be done, but it has to be business unusual.
Absolutely.
My students.
Absolutely. We need a lot of intervention. Yeah, sorry.
As a teacher, I'm getting old, but with you, Dr. Srivastav, there being my teacher, I think it encourages me very much.
You will never get old. None of you get old, because you all work. You all work. Right. So how will you get old?
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. Till next Saturday. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.